Hello and welcome everyone to the MedTech session of Entrepreneur India's Innovation Summit 2020. I am Saurav Kumar, editor, Special Projects, Entrepreneur India, moderator for the session. While a lot of us may not realize so, but deep tech based technology, technological applications have a profound impact on everybody's life, from financial services solutions to medical equipment. These technologies improve efficiency. For blockchain, for instance, is not just limited to cryptocurrencies anymore, but it is used for mobile applications and banking services. So these technologies are transforming the future through new drug discoveries, genome editing, and disease eradication. Of course, telemedicine is to know more about the role of technology in healthcare for a future, we have a great panel today. I'll introduce my panel first before we move to question and answers. We have with us Prashant Warrior, co-founder and CEO, Cure.ai. Ajit Narayanan, co-founder and CTO, M5. Dr. Geeta Manjunath, CEO and CTO, Niramai. Ryan Collins, Managing Director, Mass Mutual Ventures, and Dr. Vedam Ramprasad, India CEO for MedGenome. Thank you everyone for being here. So, I'll just very quickly request everyone to, tell our audience the basic, technology that everyone you are using in your business very briefly, and then we can take up the, we'll go ahead with the question and answer. So, Prashant, if I can start with you.
Certainly. So I'll share my.
If you can have the speech for him, Prashant.
Can you see my screen, everyone?
Yes, we can. Okay. Go ahead, please.
So we are Cure.ai. We use AI to interpret radiology images. And what you see on the screen is a suite of our solutions. I'll quickly talk about what we do. We are using deep learning algorithms to automatically interpret chest x-rays, for example, or HCT scans. And as of today, we are in about 28 countries impacting around 10,000 plus lives on a daily basis. We are processing about 10,000 plus scans daily. And quickly talking about, we receive an x-ray, and the output that we produce is something like this. I just wanted to bring this about, right? So we are able to identify abnormalities. This is a chest x-ray solution. So we're able to identify abnormalities on a chest x-ray. We can detect, we added a COVID risk, COVID finding recently. So we can detect COVID risk. We can identify where the abnormalities are, what percentage of the lung is affected. We can detect about 20 different abnormalities across the lungs, pleura, mediastinum, heart, and so on. And we can detect, we can triage for COVID, and we can screen for tuberculosis. And what you see on the right side is an automated report that is created by the algorithm. So this is what goes in. What goes in is only the X-ray, and what comes out within a minute is this whole report, which can be run on the cloud, on premise, and it can integrate with the device, with the software systems, whatever. We have various ways of integrating with the healthcare system, right? Now, this is being used in various locations. We are using this for tuberculosis screening in Philippines. So there, quickly I'll talk about the challenge there, is that they have these mobile vans which go into the city, which basically start from Manila. They go into basically some parts of the city, or they will go into rural areas, and they would screen about 200 people every day using chest x-rays. So these vans have an x-ray unit, but unfortunately, they don't have a radiologist to read the x-rays. So what we are doing is we are automating the read of the x-ray using AI, both when there is internet connection available, it goes to the cloud and gets processed. If there is no internet connection, it gets processed locally. And by that, we are able to reduce the time for tuberculosis diagnosis from somewhere like 3 weeks to a minute, 2 minutes. So that's the improvement, which reduces the number of people who are lost to follow up, basically people who come in for the x-ray, but then by the time their x-ray is read, they are lost, right? You're not able to find them. And also the algorithm is able to detect more TB cases. A similar thing, we have done this in many parts of the world, but also did that for COVID in Mumbai. We are working with the Municipal Corporation of Greater Mumbai, where X-rays cannot really screen for COVID-19. But what you can do is, I mean, what this bus, this is a COVID bus, which is going into Dharavi and it is going into Varli, Kolivada, various parts of the city where you don't have access to any X-rays or any even basic healthcare. And what this bus is doing is they will take SpO2, they will take an X-ray, they will look at the symptoms of the patient. And based upon all of that, now you can triage who needs to be swabbed. So a PCR test is not available for everybody. You cannot PCR test thousands of people every day, but you can X-ray thousands of people every day. You can do an SpO2 test for many people. So this is a screening or a triaging mechanism that is being used in Mumbai right now. This is also being used in other parts of the world. Just talking about ways our algorithm is being used. Again, because we can mark out where the abnormalities are on the lung, you can use that to measure progression of COVID-19. This is being used in Europe, in multiple sites, UK, Italy, and so on. So this is the kind of report that our algorithm generates, all automatically created within a minute, right? And this is also an interesting use case, talking about what we do. I mean, if you look at chest X-rays, out of 100 chest X-rays, about 60, 70, maybe 80 are normal, and the rest are abnormal. And if you can automatically, so the normal X-rays will always have the same report. I mean, all the different parts of the X-ray are normal. Your lung is normal. Your bones are normal. Ribs are normal, and so on. So this is a radiology customer in Southeast Asia. And what we are doing is we are reporting all the normal cases for them, which can then be quickly reported by their radiologist technician. So out of 100, we are able to identify about 68.4% as normal. And that is auto-reported by the algorithm without a lot of work from the radiology team. So, and these reports can also be released very quickly. So within 1 minute, we can report. And then within 5 minutes, they are able to report these scans. So substantially speeding up reporting. And there are places where we are completely auto-reporting chest X-rays, where this is a fully automated report created by the algorithm, which is pending radiology signature. They can edit this report and then give it out to patients. So we can create a fully automated text report for patients. The other solution that I wanted to speak about is our head CT scan solution, which can detect bleeds, fractures, stroke, basically trauma and stroke, right? Bleeds and stroke. And this is deployed in several sites. I'm talking about one site in Kerala where they don't have radiologists throughout the day. So what we do is we receive these scans automatically from the CT scanner. Whenever we have a critical scan, we will receive these scans on our cloud server and we process them within a minute. And if we identify a scan which has got a critical abnormality, that will be sent to the radiologist's phone as a Telegram message here, but also as a WhatsApp message. And they can report on that immediately, saving probably hours of time for a patient, which could mean life and death for that patient. If you're able to report on a stroke or a trauma case half an hour earlier, that is life and death for a trauma or stroke patient. So that's what we do. I mean, we are, in about 110 plus sites in about 28 countries. As of today, we are processing on an average about 10,000 plus cases on a daily basis. So quick summary of your.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you so much for the presentation. A quick request to our attendees who are here. If you have any questions for our panelists, you can post it through the discussion box on the right-hand side of your panel. And we'll take up the questions post the discussion. Can we have all of us on the stage, please? And if I can request Ajit, if you can... please tell us, the innovations, technological innovations that you have done to, provide identifying that you are doing.
Sure, absolutely. So let me.
If you can give the screen, please.
Can you see my screen?
Yes, please. Yes.
Okay, so. Good afternoon, folks. So my name is Ajit. I'm the founding member and CTO of Mfine. We are a primary healthcare company. Our goal is to provide quality healthcare on demand, right? So that's what we are set out to do. What are we trying to solve? If you look at primary and secondary healthcare today in India, the delivery of it, I think there are two fundamental problems with it. One is that quality care and quality doctors are very far and few, right? There is one specialist doctor for around 5,000 people. There are, the reach of these doctors, the good doctors are, you know, limited to their geographies. And you have pretty long travel times and wait times if you want to get to see a doctor. And if you talk about specialists, that gets even more harder. The delivery process itself is completely broken. So if you look at it, quality care itself is a questionable thing. There are, you know, bad health decisions being done, like self-medication, substandard treatments. There are no protocols that sort of exist and are being followed across the entire country. There is no tech standardization at all to deliver quality at scale. All of this, right? So these are, you know, two core problems that actually dog the Indian healthcare system. And we wanted to come and solve that. So our solution is the following. So we sort of build the a network of the best care providers in the country. So if you look at the top doctors, how do you scale them infinitely to actually to serve all the demand of the country is what we are looking at. So you take the best of the best doctors. You use their consultations and whatever they do as a forms to form a data engine, meaning you learn from these good doctors. You replicate that using, sort of formulating a virtual doctor. In some sense, you create a digital twin of these great doctors. And then you scale that over mobile so that it is accessible to most of the country, right? So that's what we try and do in MFind. So we are an AI-driven virtual hospital. So we aggregate the best doctors and the best care providers of the country. So for consumers, this becomes instant virtual visit to the hospital from the comfort of their homes. They have access to almost 30 specialties on their phone. We offer, you know, at-home services for diagnostics and medicines and so on. And of course, our AI helps in giving them digital tools to for them to stay healthy. And for hospitals, of course, it's a no capital, easy scale mechanism for them to actually reach out to maximum number of patients as possible who need that care, right? Our core product is built on AI. So we have a learning system which learns, which understands deep medical knowledge. So it understands the semantics across these 30 specialties that I talked about. We have treatment protocols that is built and diagnosis algos that we have learned from these doctors over a period of time, right? In the 3 years of that we have that existed in the industry today. And it manifests to the consumers in an extremely fast, efficient way to meet the doctors. And it manifests to the doctors in a way that it makes them extremely efficient on the platform. So what used to take around 30, 40 minutes in a face-to-face visit should not take more than 5 minutes because the system captures all of that information, is able to break it down, do a triaging, do emergency analysis, define the treatment plans and so on and so forth, that doctors can easily make those decisions, right? So that's what we are building out. So today we cover close to around 1,000 odd symptoms and findings that we can do automated. We diagnose around 1,200 conditions with close to around 85-90% accuracy between that. We have hundreds of templates that we have learned from these doctors that makes the whole process very fast. Just to remind you, this AI is assistive in nature. It is not directly to consumer, of course, right? It is helping the doctors to become extremely efficient. And that's how we bridge the scale difference between the number of patients in the country and the very fragile and few, the care ecosystem that exists in the country. And that's the goal that we are after. Yeah, that's it from me.
Yeah, thank you, Ajit. Thank you. That was really insightful. If I can ask Dr. Geeta to explain what Niramai is actually doing in terms of technology, and if we can give her the speech, please.
Sure. Can you see my screen?
Yes, we can see your screen.
Yeah. Hi, all. This is great to be here. I'm basically going to talk about a bit about what we are doing at a startup called Niramai. Niramai stands for being healthy in Sanskrit. That's what it means. And it also expansion non-invasive risk assessment through machine artificial intelligence. That's exactly what we do. We use AI to detect health risks in a non-invasive way. And, just to sort of give the context of where we started and, given the COVID screen, and just give you a very most simple and brief glimpse of what we're doing using AI for fighting cancer. That's where we started off with. Basically, more than 500,000 women die every year due to breast cancer. And this is due to a lot of issues that exist today. That there is no good test for women under 45 years of age. There's what's called dense breast. A lot of, more than 50% of the people, even above 45 years, are not able to detect only cancer using mammography, which is the de facto standard, and so on and so forth. Of course, affordable accessibility makes preventative care, early detection, very, very difficult in countries like India. So, given this whole scheme of things in the context, what we came up with is a new solution for detecting breast cancer to start with. So, this is basically a privacy-aware early-stage breast cancer detection solution, where we just use a thermal imaging device, measure variations on the chest, and then use machine learning and AI algorithms to detect and generate a report. I mentioned, it is for a doctor to sort of review it and then make a final decision. But yes, we do this completely automatically. And of course, when we go to rural areas and all that, when doctors are not around, this can be used as a triaging device. Now, what does this do and what are the advantages? Very quickly, first and foremost, most women detect breast cancer using hand, which is accidentally feeling a lump which is about 25 millimeters in size, which is stage 3 or stage 4. We are able to detect 4 and 5 mm of cancer, much before a lump is felt, so many years before. And so early detection has better treatment efficacy, as you know, and also most importantly, even after a surgery, the lady can live 30, 40 years without much recurrence, because it's a very, very early sort of, nipping the bud kind of situation that we bring in. Another most important part of this is, because it's completely non-contact, non-invasive, we say it is no touch, no see. That is, it's really like a changing room experience. The lady comes in and she goes out she goes into a booth for, she stays there for 10 minutes and she goes out, her report will be ready. So basically nobody would have seen her, nobody would have touched her, completely sort of, automated environment around her, which of course it's controlled from outside, but still, she feels really, really private and nice, and more women really love this to actually get a breast screening done. And of course, there are a lot of other advantages, which we'll talk about later. The key technology that we have developed here is what we call as thermolytics, which is a combination of thermography or what's called as using infrared imaging with machine learning. So essentially, this is about deep learning and machine learning and all of these wonderful stuff, which basically crunch the 400,000 temperature points per person that we measure, and then generate a full-fledged 3-page PDF report with all of these explainable features, explainable, like BI-RADS scoring, which is what is very commonly used by radiologists and so on and so forth. All this is done within, the testing, the preparation, everything is done within 15 minutes. And this is what is the value that people are seeing. And this can be done not just in hospital, it can be done outside and many other places. And of course, this is innovative, proven by our 9 granted US patents so far in this technology alone. Now, of course, it's a computer-aided diagnostics. And then when we face this situation of COVID, which never, ever anyone on this world or planet has actually seen such a challenge that is posed to the world, we said, what can, as technologies, as innovators, what can we do to this, right, to save this? And then we said, we are using thermal imaging, and what can we do differently? So given that there is this huge lockdown of India and people are coming back, and we all know that at least, we need to catch symptoms like fever and respiratory abnormalities before a person gets into a community kind of a setting. So we've come up with another solution very recently called Miramai Fever Test, which is a fully automated community screening solution. We can talk about this a lot more. If there's interest, please contact. But basically, the idea is, as and when people come in, there's like face detection, several other features, it enables you to accurately determine the temperature of every person and do a log. And also we are able to detect respiratory abnormalities and all this while the person is just walking by, and it obviously enables compliance as well. This of course, has been used in the entrance of buildings. And what's interesting is like 600 people were screened in a mass screening like this as well. And the same technology has also been integrated into Mitra Robo from Invento. So many of you would have seen this, viral video where it was installed in Fortis. And, you know, it is this robo which does the full screening and the complete fever test is integrated into it. There's a lot more we want to talk about, but, we've received excellent information and support from media and other, ecosystems such as yourself. And what I want to leave, with you is that Niramai is the only Indian startup in the top 100 AI startups in the world. And we are very proud to put India on the AI world map. Okay. Thanks a lot. And happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Geeta. And we really appreciate, what Niramai is doing. It's a very common thing that, people don't know, but we need to be very aware about it. Thank you so much. Dr. Vedam, if I can come to you and, if I can ask you that if you can explain to our audience the technologies that are being used at MedGenome. And just before you start, I'll again request our attendees to, post their questions if there are any for the panelists. If it is directed to someone, do mention the question. We will take them up post the presentations. Thank you so much. Go ahead, Dr. Vedam.
Yeah.
Can we have the screen, please? Can we give the stage to Dr. Vedam, please?
Yeah. Hello. Not sure. Okay. So we are basically at the intersection of genomics and data. And we try to use the genomic data using various algorithms, bioinformatic pipelines, and make interpretations. So I'll try to make this very simple here. So every living organism has a source code. The source code is either in the form of what we call DNA or RNA. So whether it is a small virus or complex living beings like humans, we all have cells inside the body. We are made of 3 trillion cells, and each cell has a nucleus. Inside that, there is a source code, which we call DNA. And this DNA has some specific chemical entities, which we call nucleotides. It could be adenine, thymine, cytosine, or guanine. So this source code dictates the whole of life as to how, whether the individual succumbs to a disease or is susceptible to a disease, or how his health is, what is his longevity. Every aspect of the disease, starting from pure genetic diseases to as complex diseases like COVID infection, whether an individual will get a severe infection or a mild asymptomatic infection, are driven, deep-rooted into our genes and the source code. So what we do at MedGenome is our daily job is to sequence these genes most of the times in humans, individuals, in the context of diseases. It could be a rare inherited disease, or it could be a cancer. It could be a breast cancer, colorectal cancer, or any other tumor. It could be leukemias, or it could be even bacteria or viruses, and sequencing, trying to understand them. So this source code is not small. For example, if you take humans, we have 3 billion letters in each cell. In each cell has 3 gigabases of data. So today we talk biology in terms of data. So we have 3 billion letters sequencing from each individual, which when we sequence several number of times, it turns out to be about anywhere between 150 to 200 gigs of data from each human sample that is sequenced here. Once we sequence, there's a huge amount of information we have to correlate with in the context of disease, a specific disease as to why this individual is getting this disease, or in the context of treatment and management as to whether this particular situation or a disease or a tumor can be treated with specific drugs or can be managed in slightly different way. So the applications are huge as far as the medical genomics is concerned. It can be prediction, it can be prevention, it can be treatment, management, starting from all stages of life, starts from what we call, if you are trying to do a population surveillance as to in India, how many individuals are susceptible for certain rare diseases, to as simple, trivial things like whether this particular COVID virus in an infected individual is coming from Europe or coming from China. So you can trail them, you can do a lot of surveillance, you can do phylogenetic analysis, you can identify individuals as to what exact precise disease they have, solve the diagnostic or disease. We can give clinicians valuable information day on day-to-day basis as to how they can treat an individual much precisely and much better than the conventional method that has been there. So this whole thing, what I summarized so far, happens every day, every week, 24/7 almost. From the time we sequence the data from a biological entity, it could be a blood sample, it could be a saliva, it could be a tumor, it could be any other sample. From that, we sequence this data, and we have complex algorithms, bioinformatics pipelines. Many of them are proprietary, a couple of them are patented, and we also use a lot of public tools. We have a large team of about 120 bioinformatics experts who piece out this data. And finally, the source code of that individual is given to our analysts. These analysts will tease out and do the interpretation, which is the most challenging thing. Use a couple of AI tools and machine learning tools, and finally identify that particular defect, one specific or two specific defects in the source code as to why an individual has this disease, a particular disease, and help the clinician with the diagnostics and also help them in aiding in better treatment and management. So this is what we do as a part of it. But apart from this, we also discover new biology, new entities, help various pharma in early discovery of drug molecules, targets. And we also work as a clinical research organization with various entities trying to help them solve their problems. So we are the, again, to come back, we are at the intersection of genomics data and big data biology.
Thank you, Dr. Vedan. Thank you so much. Just to follow on, can you, for the benefit of our audience, you can just tell us one use case that we all would know, may not know, but you know, which you know, your kind of solutions actually has helped you know, the normal ordinary population.
Yeah. So I can give you two examples. One, I will take a non-oncology disease. For example, there are several rare inherited diseases which happen in populations, and especially the demography of India is pretty large. India and China, we have about 60 to 70 million new cases every year with the rare inherited genetic diseases. And most of these diseases do not have any treatment. They have high morbidity. Some of them die in the early part of their life, and they cause both the social and mental burden for the families. So, and another challenge is in countries like India, especially if you take the southern part of the country, there is a practice of what we call consanguinity, which increases the probability of rare inherited diseases. So we have a solution, what we call it as carrier testing, where we sequence a couple before marriage or before conception. And most of the times, these families or these couples, they either had a disease burden in their family already, or their first kid already had a genetic disease. So they don't know why this has come, what is the problem, exactly what is the mutation, and what is the disease, and how they can preemptively know beforehand whether the next kid is going to get this disease or not. So in these situations, what we do is we screen the couple. We sequence the genomes, basically, and slice and dice with the data. And there are a lot of clinical information that gets into this. And we identify then one particular defective gene, which is basically causing this disease, because in recessive inherited diseases, a terminology we call, where the couple have 50% of the genetic defect, but they don't manifest the disease. But the kids, when they get 100% defect, they get a very nasty disease. So we identify this 50% of the disease in the kids. We had several individuals. In fact, every day we do anywhere between 150 to 200 patients or couples. We screen them, identify that particular mutation which is causing this disease, and inform their clinical practitioner, and also do a post-test counseling, so that when the couple go for a next child, we can get the fetal sample and sequence this fetal sample and identify whether that particular mutation is there present in that fetus to be born kid. And if it is there, depending upon the severity of the disease, they opt for selective medical termination of pregnancies. Or if it is a mild disease, they gear up for the better management treatment the moment the baby is born. So this is something, one of the common ones that we do. The second example which I would like to give you is a more common in oncology setup is, today, lung cancers in India and in rest of the world also, no medical oncologist treats the lung cancers without doing the genetic testing or what we call molecular testing, because 80% of the therapies today are what we call targeted therapies. And very personalized precision medicine, where an individual's genetic profile needs to be known, or a tumor profile needs to be known before giving a treatment. So if gene A is mutated in that particular lung cancer tumor, then they give a drug A. If gene A, B is mutated, they give it drug B. And the responses, the overall survival, the prognosis is completely different compared to not doing a kind of a genetic testing and giving a targeted therapies. So today it has become a well-established norm across the governing bodies, or you take societies, or the lung cancer societies, that every medical oncologist or surgical oncologist who treats a lung cancer, especially the non-small cell lung cancer, have to test for at least 3 to 4 important genes in the tumor, before which it is not considered as a basic norm to start a treatment. So this is creeping into practice of medicine very fast, and in certain specialties it has become a as a standard dictum, something like MRI or PET scan you do routinely. If you take pediatric neurology, or if you take even some of the oncology setups like lung, breast, ovarian, it's becoming very common. Only one thing is the awareness is still low, even in the clinical specialties. I think it's growing fast, because more and more actionable things are happening based on this information. We hope in the next couple of 2 to 3 years, it's going to be, at massive proportions, people will use this technology for the better kind.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Vedan. Thank you. That was really insightful, things which otherwise people, do not know. So I'll now request Ryan, if you can come and we can give the stage to Ryan. Ryan, quickly take a minute to, explain, to let us know, our audience, what you do. And since we have questions coming in already, so I think I'll also pass on one question that has come from Neha, from our audience. And she says that in the healthcare industry, we are seeing increasing adoption of technology, whether AI, robotics, blockchain, that variety of companies are adopting. So what is your opinion in terms of the longevity or the future of such technologies in a post-pandemic world where social distancing norms may eventually fade? Can we have Ryan on the stage, please?
Do I need to do something?
Yeah, please. So if you can just start off with, what investments you do, and introduce yourself. And then, as I said, that we have a question which has come in, so I thought I'll just pass it on to you now. So Neha. Neha has asked, what is your opinion in terms of the longevity or the future of, adoption of technologies in a post-pandemic world where social distancing norms may eventually fade?
Yeah, I mean, so we think, and we certainly hope, given that this is one of our investment focus areas, that the technologies that we're seeing being developed now, well, they're actually already in development, that the adoption of which is being accelerated during this crisis out of necessity continues, and that it really just accelerates the adoption of these things. So, teleconsultation is a good example that we were talking about a little bit earlier, and that it's been around for a while and had seen varying degrees of success around the world. But now I think in the last few months, certainly I've used teleconsultation a few times and have had medicine delivered to my house, and lots of people are feeling that is quite a benefit. So I think, I mean, even I'm sitting in Singapore, I'm not very far from a doctor, and it doesn't take me very long to get there, have the appointment, get my medicine and leave. And I didn't really use teleconsultation platforms before for that reason. But now, having been basically forced to use it while we've been on lockdown, then I would certainly use that again in the future. There's no need for me to physically go and see a doctor. If they're able to deal with something over a video call. If they're not and they request that I go in, then obviously you have to go in. But I think we'll see that hopefully play out across the whole ecosystem in digital health, where you've got everything that we've looked at today, whether it's diagnostics, remote patient monitoring, digital therapeutics. I mean, these are all things that hopefully, unfortunately, it's a shame it's taken this current situation to see these things getting adopted. But if we see those things being adopted faster, at the end of the day, they help provide better access to and quality of treatment for patients, and it saves time for clinicians, and it saves the cost to whether it's the employer or the patient or insurance companies paying the bill. That just seems to be something that's irreversible.
Okay. So I'll request the admin to put everyone on the stage. So we have a lot of questions coming in. So, I would really want to pick up from there. So I as I see that there are a lot of innovation that is happening, and, this is to ease, of course, the customer to the users, of course. So there's a question by Dr. Avi Nahar. He wants to know that what is the response of medical consultants when these technologies are introduced to them? He also specifically mentions that while we are struggling with the basic healthcare infrastructure in India, how adaptive is our medical fraternity to the esoteric and special such as genomics? So, Ajit, if I can start with you and then move on to others.
Sure. I think in some sense, there is the answer also in that question. The point is, today in India, the healthcare system is broken, right? And in some sense, these technologies actually come to help that very situation. So if you just look at it, even in COVID, if you just look at how, even in advanced countries, what failed was the centralized healthcare system, right? Lack of beds, lack of the experts at the points where is where things started to break apart, right? I mean, if you saw in Italy or the US and so on and so forth. So I think the centralized ecosystems and healthcare will have a breaking point. And in India, that's even a worse problem. I mean, we don't have access to healthcare in many cases, and access to good doctors and so on and so forth. So I believe the technologies that we are all building, and I think everybody in the panel here, helps to ease the burden on the healthcare system. The already broken and fragile systems is what we are helping to solve. Whether it is a case of M-Fine, where we are saying, look, at the time that a doctor needs to spend to really come to a conclusion on something is reduced because a lot of technology is going to help you in that, or whether it is automated ways in which a chest X-ray can be screened, or the breast scans can be done. These are technologies that are helping the system as it is today. So I think they will see increased adoption. I think in some sense, the situation today has brought that to light. And very clearly, at least in our case, we can see a lot of acceptance to this, especially if it is assistive in nature. I think we've seen doctors and consumers lap it up, very well. At least this is my observation.
Okay. Ryan, how is it? What has been your observation in terms of medical consultants, accepting these newer technologies, newer innovations that are happening across?
Yeah, I think I guess a little bit similar to the comment I had to the person who asked the question is we are seeing an openness both from consumers and clinicians and frankly everybody across the healthcare value chain to adopt these technologies because as Ajit said, just the burden on the system is too much for anybody, so it's kind of being forced through the current situation, but I think ultimately it will result in much better outcomes. And we've seen that again through everything from just sort of relatively straightforward teleconsultation to the diagnostic solutions and remote monitoring things that, that you've heard from some of the other panel members.
Okay. So, you know, we have run out of time, but we have a couple of questions, so I'm not letting them go before I let you answer those questions. So, you know, Abhishek Thakur asks that, you know, how do you see the future of personalized medicine affordability? Prashant, if I can come to you, you know, in terms of, you know, you providing, you know, these X-rays and everything. So, what happens to affordability? Because there's a cost attached to what you're doing.
So, I mean, in reality, I mean, what we are doing is reducing costs substantially, right? I mean, and lots of places we are improving the productivity of radiologists by 30-40%. And if you look at radiology salaries across the world, I mean, in the US, an average radiologist makes about close to $500,000, I mean, 400 to 500K a year. And the cost of reading a scan, chest X-ray is about $15-$20. HCT is about $50. And that, I mean, of course, the numbers are smaller in India, but the scale is very similar. And even in India, radiology is one of the most wanted. I mean, I think doctors who do the MDs prefer radiology because that is a well-paid profession, right? So what we are doing is, I mean, making it cheaper for individuals. I mean, as we are reading this, they're improving productivity, improving accuracy, and making radiology more affordable and accessible. And affordability is one part. The other part is that we can bring it to any part of the country, right? We have gone to really, really small towns in Malawi. I mean, where we could not have had radiology access. We have provided that. Even in India, we have gone to rural areas like Baran, where quality radiology access is always a problem, and we can bring that. So my feeling is that AI and these deep technologies will only improve affordability and accessibility, and they're not going to increase the cost for patients.
Okay. Dr. Geeta, do you think it holds true for across, not only radiology, but others, wherever there is technology coming in? Of course, there's a cost attached to it. There is, will it be personal, personalized medical available for the country?
Yeah, so Prashant already talked about the radiology part. From a personalized medicine, I would say, though I'm not an expert, but clearly what we should see is the value that it actually brings, right? By personalizing medicine to a particular user, you are, instead of trying like 3-4 different treatments, right? You're just saying, instead of the 3 treatments, we are telling you which among the 3 is most useful for you, and then doing that first, right? So if you look at the long life cycle of the treatment itself, it's actually saving cost for them at the end of the day, even if you are paying a little bit more for the analysis of figuring out which treatment it is. And also it's all about, there's so much data available. And so the doctors are also overwhelmed with this sort of huge data that's available with them. So making the right decision for the first time, which treatment that needs to be done, requires this crunching, on a second type of thing. And that's again where technology can help and enable the doctor to make the right kind of decisions. For example, treatment planning is one such application that one could build, where you would say, okay, for this treatment, what's the probability of success? For this treatment, what it is? For this particular person, knowing all the personalized data about the person, right? So that definitely helps in two ways, though there's a small markup probably for the additional analysis that is done. In the long run, it saves the person from trying different treatments. Just from an economic perspective, that itself is a huge benefit. In addition, obviously, it has better treatment efficacy. Right? That's the reason why we are personalizing it. So I think all these technologies that we are talking about, that we talked about earlier also, are going towards, in some way or the other, making, affordable, high-quality healthcare possible at scale, right, to all people.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Geeta. So we've run out of time, and I have to give the attendees time to take through the networking hour that we have followed. So thank you, everyone, so much. It was insightful for me as well to know that there are so many things that ordinarily when we subscribe to a medtech service, we don't even understand that what goes behind it to make that the bring to us, and what's the what are the intricacies that are being used by startups and doctors and investors. So thank you everyone so much, and I wish that we had more time to continue this session, but I'll have to give attendees a little breather. Thank you so much. I hope to see you all again sometime. And for attendees, this is our networking hour. So, you know, we resume our stage 3 at 1:45 p.m. India time. So, please feel free to contact other panelists and whoever is available on the stages, on different stages, and we'll see you at 1:45. Thank you so much.